Welcome to Washington County's breakfast forum from presented by the Westside Economic Alliance. There we go. I know, it's such a great day, and we're all here, got good friends around us. It's always fun to socialize a little bit, but we got to get the festivities started today. I'm Andy Dyke. I'm the chair of the Washington County Board, and I'm also, thank you, Lou. You can always count on Lou. Now I have to say good things about you, Lou. I'm also, along with Lou and several others, on the board of directors for the Westside Economic Alliance. And today we have a very special program for you. The series presents several of our mayors this morning. And I wanted to say a couple of words about the mayors. You know, I really am very lucky to be the chair of Washington County and working with some of the best mayors in the region. And it's not by accident. The mayors have worked very hard to communicate with each other and to make Washington County as a whole the best place to be in the state of Oregon. So we're going to hear a little bit about why that is today. Yeah. let's give them a hand. They deserve it. Thanks. So today we're going to hear from several of them, and we're going to hear why that is, why they work together, and just watch the way they interact, and you'll see that we all have something very special here. Yeah, there's going to be some good-natured bantering. I can count on that from probably Jerry and Denny, but that's all in good fun. So I'd like to continue the festivities by introducing our executive director, Pam Treese.
Good morning, and thank you so much for being here. As Andy mentioned, I'm Pam Treese. I'm the Executive Director of Westside Economic Alliance, and welcome to our breakfast series. I want to thank Comcast for being our sponsor. I have the good fortune, we all have the good fortune at Westside Economic Alliance, to work with Tim Goodman. Tim is very active on our Government Affairs Committee. He has been a great sponsor through Comcast of our events. He sponsored this event last year, and as we were outlining the breakfast series forums, he said to me, "Now don't forget, I want to do the mayor's forum." So Tim, thank you so much for everything that you do for us. We really appreciate it. And now what I'd like to do is introduce the mayor. So if you would come up and take a seat, that would be great. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to introduce each one of the mayors, and I'm going to ask them to tell us what their city population is. So, and you know, we'll start with Mayor Krisanna Clark from Sherwood.
Oh, yeah, get the mic away from Lou.
So our population is just shy of 19,000.
Mayor Ogden.
We have 26,164 happy souls and one sourpuss.
I'm holding up the sign because last time I had Comcast service, we had a little problem, and the guy called the other driver, and he says, "Oh, I know where the mayor Cornelius lives." And I said, wait, let's check this for a minute. I've only been doing this for 5 years. The guy gets back to me and says, you're right. That was three mayors ago. So, Jef Dalin, Mayor Cornelius, 12,131. His last number is from Portland State.
You can have the mic back. No, Pete's got it on.
Mayor Truax from Forest Grove.
22,000.
Mayor Knapp from Wilsonville.
Hi, we're about 23,000 at this point.
Great. Mayor Doyle.
Closing in on 95,000.
And Mayor Willey.
Recently announced 102,000.
Wow. Well, that's remarkable, and thank you all for, first of all, knowing exactly how many are in your population base. That's great. What we've done here this morning is we have got a series of questions that the mayors are going to be asking each other. My job is just to make sure that the microphone moves from place to place. That is going to be the hardest job in this room this morning. So we're going to start with Mayor Clark, and Mayor Clark is going to be asking her question, and they don't know who's going to be asking them the question. So guess what, Mayor Willey? Krisanna Clark is going to be asking you a question.
Well, that's good. My favorite mayor of the whole bunch, so.
Well, I am the rose among the thorns up here.
Yeah.
So. Mayor Willey.
Do you realize there's six of us following you?
Uh-oh. Sorry. The U.S. Census. Now, and I must read this because, wow, this is a statement and a question, a statement and a question, sir. The U.S. Census now estimates Hillsborough's population at more than 102,000 people. South Hillsborough is projected to add another 20,000 residents over the next 20 years. Existing Hillsborough neighborhoods such as Amber Glen, Orenco Station, and downtown Hillsborough have seen several thousand new residents move into newly constructed multifamily housing in recent years. Thousands more are expected to join them in the coming years, particularly in Amber Glen. As a city, what gives you confidence that you are prepared for that growth, and are you in a position to continue to grow with the available land at present?
Before you answer that question...
Time's up.
Yeah. I was going to let you know that you have 3 minutes, each of you, to answer your question, and it's the gong. More cowbell. Okay, Jerry, go.
Yeah, that cowbell, Lou could relate to that, but... So, okay, first thing is, I want to give everybody permission. These are very, very fine outline for the day, but you have my permission to take it and turn it face down, because on the back is, of course, my favorite mayor, which is me, of course. So that was just a little bit of a jab at Teresa and putting me on the back page. I mean,
well, enjoy it while you can. You got about 6 months left, raw counting.
I know. I'm on my way out the back door, so I guess that's it.
There is a God.
Has my 3 minutes started yet?
Yes, it has.
Unfortunately, yes.
Dang. Hillsborough, I think, has for centuries has been focused on visionary growth. And back in the 60s, they were talking about water supply. They were talking about future water resources. We certainly have done that, and we've continued to do that with the Willamette Water Study and project that we are underway with all the other cities and certainly the county and many other agencies. I think the city itself is really active right now. Obviously, we have what I want to tell you is when you drive out the Sunset Highway, that is not a driving range. That is Top Golf, and you're going to have the most fun you've had for a long time going there. And no, you don't even have to know how to play golf. So some of the other mayors here will fit right in. We've been blessed to have over last year, this year, and next year, we'll have 9 new hotels, over 1,000 new hotel rooms in the city of Hillsborough. And then, of course, you hear about all the other things, the North Industrial Employment Areas that we spend a considerable amount of time trying to make sure that we have land availability for future employment. We have South Hillsborough where we're going to put those people so they can live, work, and play in the same city. And we can do our best to cut down on the greenhouse gas and certainly the commute time. If you've been on the freeways lately, you'll completely understand with that. If you've been trying to get out of Hillsborough, get into Hillsborough at the wrong time in the wrong street, I'm sorry. You're going to have to wait for a little bit of while. We've got a lot of construction going on. So with that, I think two things just real quickly. One is it's been mentioned about the how well the mayors get together. This is a great group of mayors. The collaboration and the leadership that I think we as a group provide to the region is really phenomenal. We like each other enough, we even go drink together. And so I think that speaks volumes. And the other thing is, it's gonna be a really, really hard push against opposing Initiative 28. And as a city, we are going to come out and say, we oppose that, and it's bad for our business, it's bad for our state, and so we hope that you join us.
Good job. No more cowbell for you. The next question is going to be from Mayor Ogden to Mayor Knapp.
And you know, just for full disclosure here, Pam asked the mayors to write down the question they want to get asked so they could brag about what they're doing. And then there was some random hat choose of who got to ask what. So I just was thrilled with the question I got. Let me read it to you. Question I got from PAMS for Mayor Knapp. Mayor Knapp, I understand that you have significant imperial interests emanating northward from Wilsonville toward Tualatin. That area has been codenamed Basalt Creek. It has been reported that Wilsonville's intention is to annex all the way up to Tualatin and perhaps even the high school. WTF! Can you tell us what progress is being made in moving this area forward on such issues? Quote, unquote.
Okay, it's not Dateline up here, okay?
Tim, would you like me to read the question?
No, that's close enough. Well, we do have some friendly competition because we're jointly working on planning that area, but Metro brought in Coffee Creek area in 2002 into the UGB and the Basalt Creek area in 2004. I was elected in 2008. In 2009, we started doing concept planning on Coffee Creek, and by 2011, I think we had our infrastructure framework plan sort of figured out for that, and in 11, we also then kind of jumped into joint planning with Tualatin and Washington County primarily, with Metro's blessing and a construction excise tax award to the city of Tualatin to fund that planning, and we have achieved a transportation plan for Basalt Creek, and we're currently working on a concept plan for Basalt Creek. So the incremental steps seem like they take forever, but we are making pretty good progress. We've kind of had a gentleman's agreement with Tualatin Council, between Wilsonville Council and Tualatin Council, going back to December last year on how we will proceed on Basalt Creek. And we have staff and consultants working on putting that into some sort of a concrete form that I'm hopeful the cities will both endorse. And so all of that takes place over time. Wilsonville has a lot of industrial growth on the north end. We've been working to move Coffee Creek into productive use. In March, the city signed off on the first real corporate application in the Coffee Creek area, which is Universal Health Systems, behavioral health hospital unit that will be a $32 million investment in that area. We'll have 190 full-time jobs and will help with veterans that need some of those services, as well as members of the general public. Interestingly, kind of matches our historic hosting of the Damage State Mental Hospital also. So we're excited to see that moving forward. We still need private investment in Coffee Creek. We need some of the private sector real estate folks to work with aggregating property ownerships, and hope to see the mental health facility being one that sort of kicks off the development in Coffee Creek, and we are looking forward to more progress there. The work with Tualatin on Basalt Creek is something that will take a little longer. It's just a little farther out, but the 1,000 acres that exist between Wilsonville and Tualatin is a significant piece of the industrial and employment growth area that the region as a whole has designated, and we look to be able to grow jobs there. Coffee Creek by itself is about 225 acres maybe of developable land, and we expect it to host 1,500 full-time jobs. We'll look for a payroll of something like $55 million. At this point, Wilsonville continues to be one of the faster growing cities, and we expect that to continue into the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Knapp. The next question is from Mayor Dalin to Mayor Doyle.
Be nice. Always, Denny, always. There's a lot of activity in Beaverton's downtown. What has the city done to make this happen?
We are certainly more succinct than some cities on questions. And since you mentioned golf, how'd you do last year at the Beaverton versus Hillsborough Golf Group? Okay. Yeah. Oh well. We're on again Friday, aren't we?
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks for the question. I think Beaverton has been busy the last few years. And in the state of the city, I really made it clear that we're done with the planning and now we're going to start doing things. And as you know, we moved City Hall from the Griffith Building over to the Round. That kick-started the entire building being leased out for the first time in its history. So we take three floors, private sector takes two, including the Congresswoman. We have really tried to partner with the private sector, as well as all our cohorts in the public sector, our friends in the nonprofit world, to start building taller housing to Beaverton. As we know, we can only go up, it's hard to go out. We've added 250 new units with a range of housing from affordable, workforce, and market rate. We have more coming online, and we've got some things I'll mention that are gonna happen next year. We have really jump-started our downtown association in conjunction with our chamber, with their blessing, which the now downtown group has already won a couple of awards for their work, and we're funding them a little bit more this next year. We're expanding our storefront improvement program throughout the Old Town area. We are putting up grants for at least seven more businesses to study how they can improve their storefront. One of the restaurants did participate and actually followed through on it. Within 2 months, they had a 20% increase in business. And you're gonna see some old things become much newer looking. Go by our landmark Beaverton Bakery. The whole bakery is getting a facelift in a real significant way. I drive by at least once a week for a donut just to check on the work. We're also investing in new art murals throughout the city, new sculptures, and we're going to try something new. We're going to put vinyl art wraps on things as exciting as mailboxes, power connections, Comcast connections, and you're going to see some fun things happen through the local artists. We're expanding our community events, bringing in thousands to our downtown. Last fall, we did our first night market at the insistence and great assistance from our diversity advisory board, which is 2 years old now and really rocking. We expected 1,000 people. We had 5,000 people show up on the plaza. You couldn't move. The parking garage, the first time in its history in 6 years, was actually full, and it was pretty exciting. We're actually improving streetscapes along Broadway. So we're trying to focus on our core area. We have a pretty strong development team in place, and I know one or two in the audience, keep it up, doing good stuff. We're really focusing on Westgate right now, and we expect this summer to have development proposals come in for 2 5-story buildings on Slopam. Anyhow, how are we doing it? First, we don't sleep, we don't rest, but really, we listen. And we've had our citizens. And you'd let him go for an extra minute with his question. So, anyhow, hopefully Beaverton will never go back to sleep, and thank you.
So if you have a minute, you certainly need to check out Mayor Doyle's tie. And if you're a Beatles fan, you will know that today is a day of significance. So I'll leave it at that and let you guess what that tie is all about. Now I would like to have Mayor Truax, speaking of socks and ties, introduce or ask a question of Mayor Ogden.
Just pass the mic over that way.
It doesn't matter what question I'm going to ask Lou. He's going to answer what he wants to anyway. So, what about transportation improvements in the city of Tualatin, Mayor Ogden?
Well, thank you, Pete. So Tualatin has been mischaracterized over the years as a place where there's occasional congestion. And you laugh. We've made some progress, and we are really, really, really seriously blessed by the cooperative efforts of many government entities. And all kidding aside, I got to tell you just a couple quick stories, if I can. When Mayor Truax was first elected, and after the recount, and we all scratched our head, really? But the very first, the next day or a day after, I got a call from Pete, said he wanted to come down to Tualatin and have lunch. And I'm thinking, I didn't even know the map opened up that far to the west. Why would he want to make that trek all the way to Tualatin from Forest Grove? And so, Pete's just been in that mode ever since of really reaching out. So appreciate that. Thank you, Pete, for all you do. So what are what's going on in transportation in Tualatin? Well, I guess I'll go kind of in reverse order. Last week, we opened up the Tualatin River Greenway Trail behind Cabela's. I don't know if Senator Cowell's in the audience or not, but that project started because of Fred Bruning at Senator Cowell two or three years ago when they first came up with the idea of developing that area, or when it was first announced that they're going to redevelop that area. And he went on record saying, we're going to contribute $500,000 to a greenway trail behind that along the river there. There obviously is part of our greenway plan to have that trail in there, so he was going to have to dedicate the right-of-way, but he didn't have to build it. But he offered $500,000. He wasn't true to his word. By the time it got around, he actually ended up spending over $600,000. That jump-started $750,000 from Roy Rogers and Andy Dyke and the Washington County Commission, which now enabled us to go to Ryan and the folks at ODOT to get a Connect Oregon grant for like about $1.65 million or something like that. Metro came in with around, I want to say, $100,000 or $200,000. Washington County Visitor Association came in with $75,000. And collectively, we put over $3.5 million into this trail behind Cabela's, basically. What that does, not only does it extend our Tualatin River Greenway Trail, it makes a connection under I-5 for the east side of Tualatin. A whole lot of folks who don't have vehicular transportation, you know, walking from the east to west to try to get to Fred Meyer's and other areas over the freeway. I mean, come on. So now we have this wonderful trail underneath the freeway. It connects to existing trails that go all the way to the eastern city limits in Tualatin over in Clackamas County, John. And back to the library, and then ends up connecting with Keokuk's Bridge over to Cook Park. Where's John?
No John.
No
John.
Vacation.
Vacation. Holy cow! What's that? So that's a big thing. Secondly, put the bell down. Secondly, 124th Avenue. That is under construction. We're extending that south down into Basalt Creek to North Wilsonville, and I got to tell you one other story. Memorial Day is Monday. Flanders Field, the poem about the Buddy Poppies. Basalt Creek was Flanders Field. You know, millions of dead bodies down there between Tualatin and Wilsonville, starting with the prison war on to the I-5 connector war, just a number of wars. When Mayor Knapp was elected mayor, I don't even know, I mean, days after, we sat down and talked about making progress in that area. The progress in Basalt Creek, 124th, although we got $20 million from the county and the state and other folks, would not have happened without Tim Knapp and the leadership and the work that Wilsonville has done to change how we do business in this area. And we still argue over semantics, and we got some wordsmithing and some little things to work through, but, you know, it's just great.
I'm sorry I asked that question. But I also rest my case. It didn't matter what question I asked.
Thank you, Mayor Ogden. Mayor Knapp, would you please ask a question of Mayor Dalin?
Yes. So one of these topics we haven't broached yet is about housing. And I wanted to ask what you believe your city's position is, Mayor Dalin, in the struggle to support housing for the homeless.
So before I jump into the homeless thing, Pam asked us to make sure we share with you guys, why do we work so well? Why does this group get along? Why do you see us jab each other? Because you don't jab people you don't like these guys have been jabbing each other up here. Oh, and Krisanna also. So
you get out of that one on your own.
You know, not only is this a good group of peers, these folks are also my friends. Just a couple examples is, just last week I wasn't able, but most of these folks were able to attend Krisanna's birthday party. During Christmas, I was over at Jerry's house for a Christmas party. And when Pete had his accident, several of us visited him in the hospital. And that's what your friends do. Pam has written how well we work together. Besides being good people, sorry, this came out at 2:00 this morning, I had to write it down. We generally are concerned for the well-being of our community and that of our neighbors. That's the real thing that links us all together. is that concern that, you know, no matter how much Lou talks, that we actually concerned about Tualatin and making sure it does well. Because when any one of us does well, all of us does well. Okay, to the question, what are we doing for the homeless? First, we're working on jobs. We have an economic opportunity analysis to increase family wage jobs in our land, the bit of industrial land we have to the north side of town. We're working through that analysis. I see Don Odermatt shaking his head. He knows he's been involved with this activity. We've gotten help from Hillsborough, Washington County. The list goes on and on. Those jobs allow people to get off the streets, to get somewhere to work. And they're family wage jobs. They're doing the dirty kind of stuff, machine shops. We've got acreage out there that actually has street power and water right there, just ready to happen. So if anybody needs to expand in this room or needs some industrial space, we're open for business. Land banking. So one of the things the cities can do and have done, and we did, is we came up with an opportunity to buy the house next door to City Hall. And that allows us to land bank that. And eventually that's going to be half the land for our library and our 41 units of senior affordable housing upstairs. So land banking is a good one. Something this group, along with the Metro Regional Mayors, has done is advocating for mental health to actually be taken back up by the state and the feds. A lot of those folks that are out there have mental health issues. We know that, and they need to be helped. And the only way we're gonna do it is not just at the city level, but at the state and the federal level. So we're advocating, and that's an important job we do. Last but not least of all is partnering with nonprofits. So we're partnering with Bienestar. We're gonna build 41 units of senior, I gotta stop saying that, I'm always doing that wrong. It's supposed to be now mature adult affordable housing. This is gonna be above our library project. And to give you an idea, those 41 units, part of the application process, Bienestar had to go out and interview and survey the folks that are already on the list at Washington County to see if they'd be interested in moving all the way out to Cornelius. They interviewed that. For those 41 units, they had hundreds of people that were interested and willing to move out to Cornelius and make that their new home. So in an attempt to reclaim a little bit of the time from Lou, I will end at that point.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And Jeff, thank you for your opening comments as well. I appreciate that. So our next question is from Mayor Doyle to Mayor Clark.
You don't want to be one of the guys. It's okay. Mayor, you are working with Washington County Sheriff's Office about a possible partnership to have the sheriff provide overnight coverage in Sherwood. Why is the city pursuing this possible alternative? And Pat's here.
He is. I already said hello. Hi, Pat. So I also want to have a few brief opening comments as well and echo some of the statements that have been made here this morning. This has been an amazing group of gentlemen to work with. I remember when I was first elected, I have to tell a little story on them. When I was first elected, I came to my first mayor's meeting, which is the private mayor's meeting that only mayors are allowed, no staff. If you can't come, then your seat's empty. And I remember walking in and thinking, okay, so what's this all about? Just a little new person. And they shut the door and they start jabbing each other about the golf and the hair. And I'm like, what's going on? And so I figured it out. I said, oh, I get it. I get it. This is the clubhouse. Okay, so I've got to be part of one of the members now. And so I turned to Jerry and I said, well, you know, Willie, that's a pretty good tan you got going on for living in Hillsboro. And he whipped around and looked at me, and Pete started, and he said, look at the freshman throwing a cuff.
That's and the best imitation of Mayor Truax I've heard.
And from then on, I was part of the gang, and they have treated me as such ever since, and I just want to thank them. for welcoming me into the clubhouse. It's been a real thrill and wonderful. So now I will answer the question that has been posed, but thank you guys. For most cities, the budget policy for the budgeting for the policing services is around 25% of the entire budget. And that's a pretty big chunk. And so I thought, you know, we received a lot of questions from our citizens and policymakers in Sherwood about our budget and about our policing service budget and the level of staffing that we have. And so we as a council decided to hire an outside independent consultant group to perform a police staffing study for us. And what they found really educated us and made conclusions for us about our policing services. And some of those conclusions I'll share with you today. An important indicator in policing is the amount of time officers have to be proactive. So proactive means that they're not actually taking calls. So they're proactive policing. They're not taking a call of service. The typical proactive time for law enforcement agencies are from 40% to 60% of the total available time for a police officer. In Sherwood, the total proactive time average was 69%. So with that, we also learned that there was a time that there was a high between 2 a.m. and 6 a.m. of 91% proactive time. So recently on a television show, national television show, The Good Wife, the city of Sherwood was actually mentioned by one of the characters. And the character was asked where they were from, and the character said, well, I'm from Sherwood, Oregon. Yeah, nothing ever happens there. Well, I think the statistics that we got between 2 a.m. and 6 a.m. is pretty accurate. Nothing ever happens there. And so, since we have those kinds of statistics, we thought, in spite of the service, we thought, you know, maybe we better look into some options, because there were things that the council also wanted to add, and also the citizens. So in spite of the service levels that we have in the city of Sherwood for our policing, there were some citizens and some counselors that really wanted additional services. And the additional services that they wanted really couldn't be provided for, because we already provide a great service, right? And some of them were enforcement officer for our youth. So it was we thought that maybe we could contract. Maybe we could contract with Washington County for that very low time. So I will conclude in saying we have asked Washington County to do that. We are very excited to hear their proposal to us in working with us in that proactive time in the late and early hours. So thank you to them, and I'm excited to see what goes forward.
Thank you, Mayor Clark. I offered the cowbell to Lou, but he declined. So our last question from the stage, and that after that we will open up to questions from the audience, is from Mayor Willey to Mayor Truax.
Thank you, Pam. As a side note, we are up here. You're looking at us, but we're looking at you, and it's the only time you'll see Doyle on the far right. Okay, I just want to tell you that.
Not very far, though.
He is just inside of me, though, so it bothers him. Mayor Truax, recently, in your high school, there was probably a bad negative message that was turned into a very positive message, and so I think we'd be interested in how the city responded and working with the school district on that. And I just want to give you and certainly the high school kids that participated kudos for making a strong message, and certainly that resonated throughout the county. So how did you respond to that? And I guess some comments on that.
Thank you very much. That was a tough incident on that Thursday morning. For those of you that don't know, we had some, for lack of a better word, some hate speech at our high school, and our Latino population was very offended by it, and justifiably. They chose to demonstrate during their break time on Thursday morning and then march from the high school through downtown Forest Grove to the district administration office to confer with the superintendent and district staff. The role the city played in that particular effort was nothing more, and nothing is, it's not a throwaway term. We supplied, along with our friends from Washington County, the traffic protection. We blocked intersections so that the students could parade without creating any incidents of traffic issues. And on the surface, that was it. And then they met with the district leaders and then returned to the high school. And for a little bit, life is going on. There are still questions to be answered. There are still issues to be resolved. The concern I have is that we had a far more important, I felt, meeting the night before. Wednesday evening, we had our Sustainability Commission in Forest Grove sponsor, along with Adelante Mujeres, a Latino summit in which various members of that community got together and voiced concerns and problems that they felt they had with the city of Forest Grove, obstacles to communication. So we are, and there was, my issue was that there was no press coverage of that. There was a boatload of press coverage on Thursday morning. And again, call me crazy, but I think the substantive meeting that we had Wednesday night will, in the long run, be far more important. So we are playing that particular role, trying to open those paths of communication, not only with these summits, but also engaging in our farmers market and those other opportunities to make sure that that the city of Forest Grove understands and communicates completely with all communities in Forest Grove, so that truly is a family. And when I say all communities, I mean not only the different ethnic and cultural communities, but also lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and the list goes on. We have a responsibility to do that. Thank you. And I'm sorry I went too long.
It was perfect. So I've had a couple questions handed to me. I'm going to ask one, I'll ask one question, and hopefully we'll have time to get to more audience questions. The first one is, Metro recently brought mayors together to talk about how to address the next UGB expansion. What do you hope will come of it?
Here you go, Jerry. Who's on the committee?
Well, I could start on that because I attended that meeting, and the mayor's group that Krisanna referenced has been active in soliciting Metro to form a task force to work on the question of UGB expansion protocols and whether there are ways to tweak the process a little bit, not to throw it out, but to tweak it in ways that would make it more responsive to what the local aspirations and needs are in our communities. And so I was pleased that Metro has been responsive to that. And we've only had one meeting, but President Hughes has committed to following through with his folks there at Metro. And so we'll see how that process goes. Wilsonville's kind of the poster child in this case because we were the only applicant that wanted a residential expansion in the last round. We didn't get it. It was pretty modest. We're looking for a couple hundred acres in order to provide housing so that we have the ability to grow these industrial areas I referenced earlier with new jobs, new employment, and not continue to overload the transportation infrastructure. So the idea of a balance between housing and employment lands, I think, is crucial to how well we plan. We can't just plan transportation. We can't just plan housing. We need to think about sort of an integrated approach. So I'm hopeful that the process will yield some consensus amongst the different stakeholders, and that includes folks that are protective of the environment and concerned about expansions and protecting farmland and all those other components, that the responsible things to do is to make modest adjustments where we can. Right now, the rules don't let logic be the foremost, consideration, and there's fairly strict set of rules. So we're hopeful that the process will yield some modest changes that allow broader considerations to fold into those decisions.
Mayor Clark, did you want to?
I just wanted, I also attended our first meeting, and I think that Mayor Knapp stated it very well, but I just wanted to also echo that I really appreciate Metro opening the discussion back up, because this is a discussion that isn't going to go away, and it's something that needs to be talked about, and as Mayor Knapp spoke on, it needs to be solved, because the current solution is not a solution, and in my city, we are a little bit unique in that my citizens, we have UGB expansion in an area that they're not real thrilled about. And so that doesn't mean that we don't need to look outside the box and say, well, maybe we need to have UGB expansion in a different area and have that opportunity and that ability, because as Mayor Knapp stated, we need to be closer to our jobs in order that we can solve transportation without just slapping down a whole bunch of roads. And so I appreciate the conversation being opened up.
Mayor Willey.
Yeah, just, I am not on the committee, but the focus has been from the Metropolitan Mayors Group, the focus has been that we feel like we need to be more strategic in how we consider expansions of the urban growth boundary, but we also need to understand that these decisions have other ramifications, and right now we're seeing a significant housing shortage, and we're seeing significant increases in rent and cost of housing, and this is driving people out of the core city into the burbs and outside of our urban growth boundary into cities like North Plains and Banks and Gaston and Sandy and Estacada and all over the region, which also at that point in time increases greenhouse gas because we are putting people on the road further to their employment and also in places where there's no public transit. So we are actually conflicting some of our goals and aspirations regionally when we make these decisions that cause that. So I think that was a big part of the focus from the Metropolitan Mayors to say, we need to sit down with our regional government and we need to sit down with our legislators and figure out a better solution to this. And so that's the hope.
Thank you.
The one thing I would just add to that, because I want to make this very clear, this is not about bashing Metro. This is not about Metro's the bad guy that's holding UGB and we can't do what we want to do in the cities. The fact of the matter is, our good friends, and I say good, I mean that, home builders 20 years ago went down and got a bill passed, 2709, that says you have to have a 20-year land supply of buildable land. That was well intended. The unintended consequence of that is it becomes a numeric calculation. It's like forecasting exactly what time it's going to rain next Thursday morning or evening. And you can't do that to that specificity. So Metro's hands are tied. They're bound by this law that says you got to project the need, and if whatever the number is, it's wrong because it's a forecast. And so if you're on the side of want more land, you sue Metro that the number's wrong. If you're on the side you want less land, you sue Metro, the number's wrong. So what we're asking to sit down with Metro so we can go together with our friends, hopefully Representative Vile and others, in the legislature that can help make that fix. But it's got to be a joint effort to go down and change the law. So it's not about us against Metro. I want to make that very clear. It's about all of us trying to figure out a way to do things in our communities that we can do individually.
You are going to have to dip this moment in bronze because Lou and I agree with each other on this one. The legislature needs to play an active role in this. Metro needs to play an active role. We need to be partners. You see up here these mayors and absent John Cook and the other mayors in Washington County that aren't here this morning, we do play well with others. We do play well with each other. And that's the kind of spirit I think that we're trying to inculcate with the rest of the rest of the region, maybe even the rest of the state. Because these problems we talk about, land use, housing, it's not just the metropolitan area, it's the entire state of Oregon. Indeed, it's the western United States. We have a huge, huge housing problem, and we just can't sweep it under the rug and let the let our children and grandchildren and people we don't know yet deal with that problem. We have to do something.
Thank you. I'd like to ask the next question. What can be done to increase safe bike and public transportation, such as bus access, especially for commuters?
Well, I think I co-chair the Washington County Futures Transportation Study, and I think that's one of the key aspects of what it is that we hope to accomplish. And just to give you a quick snapshot of that, this is a study that we're looking at the county and our transportation grid and where our major arterials are, where our major transportation conflict is. And we're trying to envision what this is going to look like 20 or 30 or 40 years from now. And so envision, if you will, the thing that we all like to talk about is autonomous vehicles, the Google driverless vehicles. Imagine that. Hard for us to imagine that, but we also really can't get our hands around, is that going to be a good thing or not? Because obviously not everyone is going to have one. And so we are looking as a county, I think we are looking out to see where our transportation issues are. Again, it's always about funding, it's about bike and ped, it's about public transit, and it's about, again, collaboration with our partners, because Washington County doesn't live in a silo. We know that we have to deal with Multnomah County, we have to deal with ODOT, we have to deal with Clackamas County. All of those organizations, plus a lot more, touch our county, and they impact our transportation options. And so I think bike and ped certainly goes along with it. Every time we improve a road, we are mandated to improve the bike and ped part of it, so it's not like that's an option that we can get rid of. And I think we're happy to do that. Public transit also has significant issues. We'd love to have rapid bus, but rapid bus requires its own lane. That requires more right-of-way. So there's all kinds of issues with that, but we're working through that, and hopefully we'll have a report back to the public by the end of this year.
Does anybody else want to add to that?
Oh, it was already on. Pam, one of the things that you talk about, the collaboration, so Forest Grove, Cornelius, and Hillsborough are working on the Council Creek Trail. Right now, people tell me they won't let themselves or their kids ride down TV Highway for fear of being run over. You know, they walk along there when they have to, but it's the only link for Cornelius and Forest Grove to get out of the West End and get into the center part of the county. So with the Council Creek Trail, we'll have a grade-separated area where you can cross out of our communities and into Jerry's. Now, that's great. You know, we see the Banks Vernonia Trail with a lot of recreation. The difference is this is also going to be able to work something like the Springwater Trail is, and it'll work as a link to allow people. Because I think through recreation, people all of a sudden discover, hey, this ain't such a bad way to get across out of town, you know, the 4 miles from Cornelius or the 6-8 miles from Forest Grove into Hillsborough. And look, right at the other end of it is the MAX station. So I think once people discover that recreationally, all of a sudden their commute will start being part of that bike because they will feel safe of getting out of town without having to be on the side of a highway.
Danny?
Just another thought, looking at it from the city's point of view. We're working with ODOT's, our partners, to do some changes to Canyon Road. We all know you go smooth, you never have to wait more than one signal change on Canyon any day of the week. But one of the things we're peeking at is a way to extend Milliken, to actually let you get off and go by 5 light rail stops all the way to the other end of town, and we're working on that. So the cities have to do some of that, but I think the key is you're hearing the partnerships. We figured out we're all in, it's a new world. We can communicate, we're all in this together, public, private, you know, the state, the county, and it's been fun watching that whole thing unfold. I'm admitting to having done this elected job for a long time, but it's really been wonderful to see the change, and those of you who live in this county should be very proud of this county, and, you know, I wouldn't want to live anywhere else, and I know I have get to travel a bit, and I brag about what we do in Oregon throughout the state through our tri-region area. we work together and we're learning how to work together better. But bicycle stuff is really important because we want to get pedestrians across canyons safely, and we want to get people from one end of town to another. So like Jeff said, we've got to work together as cities and maybe figure out a way to push them on down towards the county in Hillsborough.
And if I can tag team on that, Highway 47 is that arterial through Northwest Oregon that goes from Vernonia south to McMinnville and passes through Forest Grove. We are working with Ryan and with ODOT on improving a number of intersections with various streets and arterials in Forest Grove and in rural Washington County in our area. And it looks like when all of that is done, that it's going to be a transformational change for Highway 47. It's the key freight corridor for our part of the state. And after all of these improvements, the roundabouts, the improvements at the intersections, we are going to have a safer Highway 47. We're going to have a more accessible Highway 47. And we're going to have a Highway 47 that truly begins to meet the needs of the freight industry in Western Washington County.
You know,
thank you very much. We are at 9 o'clock. So, and one of our goals is always to end on time for our audience. So I want to thank the mayors, and I'm sure that they'll stick around for a few minutes. There is a bouquet of flowers for each of you here, but thank you very much for being a part of this. A big round of applause for the mayors.